Hello, and welcome along to what's going to be the first video in a series about dimension-driven design in MicroStation. In this video, I'm just going to introduce the concept, do some examples of what it can be used for and how it can be used, and hopefully then you can decide if it would be suitable for you or if you're interested in learning a bit more. So what is it and what does it do? I think the best way to describe that is to look at a little example here. Here I have an example of a part. Say it's a steel plate with a few holes in it and a couple of mounting holes on either corner. And what dimension-driven design allows us to do is to make modifications to that part without having to redraw anything or delete any parts, and make them quickly and efficiently and accurately, more importantly. So let's look at this part. Say if I wanted to change the width of it. I simply type in 350, the width is now 300 if you can't see that. I'm afraid I have to record these videos at a low resolution, so you may not be able to read all the text, but I'll try and explain as I go along. So the width of this part is currently at 300. If I want to change that to 350, I type it into my dialog box and hit return. And if you watch the dimension on the part over here, everything has changed automatically, and the holes have remained in the correct place, and everything is still sound. I can also adjust, say for example, the layout of that as well. That's some of the very basic things that DDD can do for us. But we can get much more advanced. I can change the hole radius here. I can change that dynamically. One thing I've added into this one, which probably isn't very practical, but for demonstration purposes, if you look at the radius of the rounding corners, I've made that proportional rather than a given value. So as the size of the overall part increases, the radius will increase proportionally. So let's do that. Let's adjust the height. You see the radius has changed to 25, whereas previously it was 18. And of course, all radii on the corners are increased. Another thing you might notice here is I have a tapping size, and this is driven by a tread size M value. So if I were to adjust that, let's have a look at this tapping size. Let's say I wanted an M value of 5 for that hole. Now I see immediately the tapping size has changed to 4.2, or even change it to 3.5, tapping size is 2.9, change it to 7 or 8, and it all gets updated automatically, and both holes are being driven there. Let's look at some other things we can do. We can, if I've built in a solution here where if the distance between these holes comes to a point where it's too small and maybe the old part will be weakened to a significant level that we don't want that, it's going to flag it up for me. So if I increase the radius of these holes so that there's a very small gap between them, you can see immediately I get a little red flag over here on the hole radius and the width. So I know maybe I'm outside my parameters there and I need to check it. And it's highlighted both of these values, so I can use either of them to fix the problem. If I increase the width, maybe a little bit more, you can see the problem has gone away. That's some of the basic things you can do with it. Let's have a look at some more advanced examples. This example here shows a railway curve, which is something that I do on a daily basis. All kinds of railway parts and components can be added in dimension-driven design, and I hope it should demonstrate that dimension-driven design can be used in any discipline, really. It can be used architectural, civil, or mechanical. And it especially becomes powerful when you have to design by things like tables, empirical formulas, and such. In this example particularly, we have what is called widening to the path of the vehicle. As the vehicle goes around a corner through a radius, the envelope of that vehicle, as shown here in yellow, has to widen as the radius decreases. I'll just demonstrate that here. If you watch the section view, you can see that envelope widening, and that allows for tolerances and for clearances so that the trains won't hit each other, basically. We also have the tilt of the train, which it is for comfort. And as I adjust the tilt on the train, the widening is taken into account. And you'll also see that the other track is sliding a little bit in order to maintain a certain clearance that's required between them. So we can put in all kinds of very advanced things. In here I have the speed value that curve is designed to be used on, and that feeds into all my other formulas in various ways. I can change the distance between the tracks, and I can change that individually from as the vehicles enter or exit the curve. I also have one more interesting one here, which is the transition length. And this is a clotide spiral that connects a straight to a circular curve, and it allows smooth transition between going from a straight to a circular curve. And in here we see I'm being given a minimum transition length, and that's been fed from three different very complicated formulae that are all derived from physics, and they're all getting compared off each other, and they don't compare in similar ways, so I'm able to feed into MicroStation very exactly which ones I need at which time, and it returns this value here so that I know my transition length cannot be below 16.25 meters. I also get reports here of things like crank gradient, rates of change, and jerk, which is very easy, very handy to have at design time, whereas it mightn't always be available in some of the off-the-shelf packages. Some of the mostly used off-the-shelf redesign packages, this kind of stuff is not available. And things like widening, which is based on my company standards from a huge table of values, is all getting fed in here, and you could never have that fed in off-the-shelf packages. So I'm actually getting more from this than I would in some of the very expensive rail design softwares. I also have schematic here as well. Let's look at that on its own and adjust some values, and I can see the schematic update as I adjust my values and test things. And that schematic is based on a scale, so that can be scaled as required. So that's another application, another example of how dimension-driven design can be used. Finally, let's talk about an issue that would be of a big concern to most people, is integrating dimension-driven design into your workflow as it stands, because it's a very big decision, you might feel, especially if you've gone through that decision that a lot of us have already about 3D, about whether that's going to be a useful addition to how we work. Say, for example, with 3D, you have to train everyone up and you have to get them all to a certain level. If you're working in a cooperative design environment, everyone needs to be at that same level for it to work properly and efficiently. With dimension-driven design, it integrates, I feel, a lot better. And it caters for different levels of users. Say if you're a beginner, you're a novice, or someone who's, say you have that the guy who's worked in AutoCAD for 5 years, and now he's come to MicroStation, he's never used it before, and you have to get him trained up. Well, he wants to get working as soon as possible, and you want him to get productive as soon as possible. So you can start him off doing the basic things like changing values on cells like that, and he's going to feel very productive when he sees that at first, and hopefully they're also going to get a little bit curious and want to know how to do this themselves and add that string to their bow, so to speak. And then you have your intermediate users who have got to that level, and they're designing their own profiles and they're prototyping their own designs, and they're working things out using dimension-driven design. And then of course you go to your top level, which is your administrator, who's going to be doing the complex solutions that are going to get reused across the board, across all your disciplines or across all your sections in your design office. And then if you've already gone to 3D and maybe you want to get into feature modeling, well, feature modeling is that's the most powerful one. It's based on dimension-driven design as a foundation for it. So that's maybe even the fourth level, where you can get all your users who are already trained up in 3D and get them back into the dimension-driven designs and make their designs more intelligent, more reusable, and more efficient. So that's your overview of dimension-driven design, and over the course of the next month, or maybe longer depending on feedback, I'll be putting a new video online every day, going from the very basics to the advanced techniques and all in between. And hopefully, if you're interested, you can join me, and look forward to interacting with you over the course of the next few weeks and the rest of the videos.